All right, lift off and the clock has started.
The era of manned space flight has begun. After Alan Shepard's historic flight, the U.S. has finally something to be proud of. But remember, there are 7 of these new astronauts, and today, we move on to the next one. And for once, this tale will be told correctly. This is the second U.S. manned spaceflight, Mercury Redstone 4, or better known as Liberty Bell 7. From a mission standpoint, Mercury Redstone 4 wasn't very different from Mercury Redstone 3. Stuck with the limitations of the Redstone rocket, for now, the Mercury spacecraft could only make suborbital hops. This would be the final manned Redstone flight, as NASA would be transitioning to the Mercury Atlas and orbital flight right after this. Flying this suborbital hop is 33-year-old Air Force Captain Gus Grissom, who had trained along Alan Shepard and John Glenn for the previous suborbital hop, Mercury Redstone 3. On launch day, July 21st, 1961, Grissom was unruffled, calm, and poised as he entered Liberty Bell 7. The countdown proceeded smoothly until 45 minutes before launch time, when a gantry technician discovered that one of the 70 hatch bolts was misaligned. A 30-minute hold was called, during which the McDonnell and STG's supervisory engineers decided that the remaining 69 bolts were sufficient to hold and blow the hatch, so the misaligned bolt was not replaced. The countdown was resumed, but 2 more holds for minor reasons cost another hour's wait.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Liftoff.
Roger, this is Liberty Bell 7. The clock is operating.
Loud and clear, Jose. Don't cry too much.
Okie doke.
Mercury Redstone 4 launched from Cape Canaveral Launch Complex 5 on July 21st, 1961.
Okay, it's a nice ride up to now.
Out and clear.
Roger. Okay, the fuel is go. About 1.25 G's. Cabin pressure is just coming off the peg. The oxygen is go. We're at 26 amps.
Roger, pitch 88. Trajectory is good.
Roger, looks good here.
Just like the previous flight, the suborbital hop is about 15 minutes. So let's take the trip with Gus. From launch to separation, the operation of the capsule is completely automatic.
Okay, there, we're starting to pick up a little bit of the noise and the vibration. Not bad though at all. There with the tower.
Roger, ready on the tower, coming to the
chase. After tower separation, which occurred 2 minutes and 32 seconds after launch, Grissom disarmed the retro rocket jettison switch.
That was great. Capsule has separated. We are 0G and turning around, and the sun is really bright.
At 3 minutes, the automatic attitude control system faced the capsule to a heat shield forward position for the remainder of the flight.
Started. Manual handle out.
Manual handle is out. The sky is very, very black. The capsule is coming around into orbit attitude.
Now almost at the top of his suborbital trajectory, Grissom went to work on his most important task, initiating manual control of his spacecraft's attitude.
Command is coming on, I'm in orbit attitude, I'm pitching up. Okay,
so the brake command is coming on, you're trying to
roll. Right, now roll here, I think, someplace. Oh, okay, I got roll back. Okay, I went 2-4 on pitch.
Roger, your IP is right on, Gus, right on.
Okay, I'm having a little bit of trouble with Rick. With the manual control.
Roger.
Thank you, stabilized here. All axes are working all right.
Roger, understand manual control is good.
Unlike Shepard, Grissom couldn't distinguish any land masses until later within the flight.
I can see the coast, but I can't identify anything.
Roger, 4 plus 40, Gus.
Okay, 3-1,
retro attitude. Retro sequence is started. Roger, retro sequence
started. As Grissom sped over the peak of his trajectory, Grissom would manually position Liberty Bell 7 for the retro fire that was scheduled to occur shortly after the zenith.
I'll give you a mark at 5:10.
Okay, retro attitude is still green.
Retro's on my mark. He's in limit. 3, 2.
3-1, do you have signal yet?
There's one firing.
Retro 1.
There's
Roger 3, all electrodes are fired.
Roger, roger. Okay, yeah, they're fired out right there.
Roger.
Devil Fox 3, Dire Fox 1, do you have signal yet?
Okay,
yeah, 3-1, do you have signal yet?
Manual fuel handle is in. Mark is going to HF.
After retro rocket fire, the retro pack was jettisoned.
And the retros have jettisoned. Now I can see the Cape. And boy, that's some sight. I can't see too much. Oh, roger, I am on UHF high. Do you read me?
Roger, reading you loud and clear. UHF high.
Okay, periscope is retracting. Going to reentry attitude.
Roger, what is that? Jettison, scope is retracted. You're going to reentry attitude.
Affirmative.
Well, 7 from Capcom, your IP is right on.
Roger, I am in reentry attitude.
During reentry, Grissom immediately reported when the 0.05 G light came on, the indication that the G low buildup was about to commence.
Got a pitch rate in here. Okay, the G's are starting to build.
Roger, reading loud and clear.
Roger.
Take note of the strain the G's put on this hardened test pilot.
G's are building. We're up to 6. There's 9. There's about 10. And the handle is off in one direction. Yeah, there I got a little pitch rate coming back out.
Commute 1 now, Fox 1, over.
This still sound good.
Okay, the oncoming is actually
65.
Commute 1 now,
Fox 1,
again,
select GBI receivers.
Okay, I'm getting some contrails, evidently a shockwave. 50,000 feet, I'm feeling good. I'm very good.
Roger, 5-0-5.
Everything is fine. 45,000, do you still read?
I'm still reading, yeah, you sound good.
Okay, 40,000 feet, do you read? Approaching drogue shoot altitude.
As the altimeter dial slipped past 21,000 feet, the drogue parachute deployed.
There's the drogue shoot. Periscope has extended.
This is 7, we have a green drogue here, 7.
The antenna canister atop the spacecraft blew off as planned at 10,000 feet, pulling the main parachute with it.
There goes the main chute, it's reefed. The main chute is good. Main chute is good.
Falling toward the water at a rate of 35 feet per second, Grissom pulled the switch to dump the remaining hydrogen peroxide fuel. Glancing at his dials, he noted another green light, indicating that the landing bag with its 4-foot impact skirt had dropped down to cushion the water landing.
Roger, and confirm the fuel has dumped, over.
Once in the water and awaiting helicopter pickup, all similarities to Freedom 7 and any other space mission are washed away. On the contrary to Freedom 7, Liberty Bell 7 had a newly installed explosive hatch. This would be the planned method of egress for this mission. But the unexpected happened. The explosive hatch blew before the planned time, causing seawater to rush into the spacecraft, putting Gus's life in danger. Luckily, Gus made it out of this alive, but Liberty Bell 7 had taken up so much water that it could not be lifted out of the water, and therefore was let go to sink to the bottom of the Atlantic. But before we get to what actually happened, let's take a look at the 1983 critically acclaimed movie, The Right Stuff, and its version of these events.
Pull the hatch after we hook on. Alright, get ready. Another 15 feet on the way.
If you're ready for me to blow the hatch, I'll have to take my helmet off.
Say again, Liberty Bell. Just waiting for your okay.
Who designed this?
Say again, Liberty Bell. You're breaking up. Can't hear you.
I can't get it off.
Liberty Bell. Liberty Bell. Say again. This is Liberty Bell 1. Waiting for your okay.
I have to say this. This is very, very wrong. Not only does this fairly good movie disrespect the then deceased Grissom by portraying him as a scared, impatient, hatch-blowing fool, but it doubles down by saying,
"Explosive hatches have been on jet fighters for 10 years. The damn things have been run inside out, subjected to trial by heat, by water, by shaking, pounding. We even dropped them from a height of 100 feet onto concrete, and not one of them has ever just blown."
This is, again, very wrong. So let's get into what should have happened, and then what actually happened. After landing in the water with a mild jolt, Grissom was ready to press ahead with the final stage of his mission. "I felt that I was in good condition at this point, and started to prepare myself for egress," he said. Before firing the hatch, Grissom was supposed to wait for a rescue helicopter to fly over, hook onto the lifting loop on top of the capsule, and raise it out of the water. Once clear, he was to remove the cap from the detonator, pull the safety pin, and activate the firing mechanism by pressing the plunger. Then he could step onto the sill of the hatch, put himself in a rescue sling, and be pulled away without ever getting wet. Now obviously this didn't happen, and the hatch blew while Grissom and Liberty Bell 7 were in the water. But the hatch blowing was not Gus's doing. If there's one thing you need to take away from this video, it is this. Why? Grissom had difficulty recollecting his actions at this point, but he was certain that he did not touch the hatch activation plunger. Okay, so how do we know that he's not just trying to cover himself by saying that he didn't just blow it? Well, let's take a trip to October 3rd, 1962. After the flight of Sigma 7, astronaut Wally Schirra stayed inside his capsule and had intentionally blown his explosive hatch to prove that Gus did no such thing. Wally said that it took around 5 to 6 pounds of fist force to blow the hatch. The brute force of hitting the plunger had cut one of the metal reinforced gloves. That wasn't all. Upon post-flight medical checkout, Wally was shown to have a bone-deep bruise on the hand he used to hit the plunger with. Gus was shown not to have such a bruise on either hand after his flight. That's still not enough for you? Then let's go even further to 1999. When Liberty Bell 7 was finally recovered out of the ocean, analysis of the spacecraft had shown that Gus did not blow the hatch. To take it even one more step, Gus was given command of Gemini 3, the first manned flight of NASA's next two-manned spacecraft. Also, he was given command of Apollo 1, the flight that would have been the first Apollo manned mission. Now, why would NASA give a man who had blown the hatch command of such crucial test flights? Simple. Gus did not blow the hatch. That's for you, Gus. May you rest in peace. Thank you for watching. And if you enjoyed this video, please like, comment, and subscribe, as this channel will be going through all of Project Mercury along with its Russian counterpart, Vostok.